Welcome back. Many of us like the idea of socking away some money for our children, and Ross Higgins of Austock Life has a few options that might be worth having a look at. Let's just see if they pass the Switzer sniff test. How are you, mate?
Yeah, good, Peter. Thanks for having me back.
My pleasure. Now, I know that these are all related to insurance bonds, so for people out there who aren't up with what an insurance bond is and not as old as you and me, what is an insurance bond?
Okay, now, last time we did all this in comparing an insurance bond with super. Now, it's a structure very much like super. Now, the great misnomer, apart from the 10-year thing, because they go a lot longer, is calling it that there's insurance, because there's actually no insurance. They're actually assurance.
And difference?
The difference is, well, they're used interchangeably, but assurance means that the life company must, under the contract, assure to pay you an amount of money, an endowment, your investment amount back.
Yeah.
And you recall the MLC and AMP, they were mutual assurance companies, not insurance.
So and endowment policies were the sort of things I talked about.
They're assurance, yeah. So it's a contract of assurance. And we have some tax benefits around that contract of assurance, which are parallel to super. Your viewers would understand tax paid.
Yeah.
Super's tax paid at 15. Insurance bonds are 30% sub 30, and they make distributions, and their preservation point is after 10 years.
Yeah.
After
10 years. After 10 years, you can access it, is it saying?
Well, no, you can access it pre 10 years, Peter, and they're quite effective pre 10 years because you'll be taxed on a growth component, but you'll get an imputation credit back of 30%.
Oh, okay. But is there more benefit waiting to 10 years and beyond?
Yeah, absolutely, because the tax benefit is perfected after 10 years, but they're quite effective pre-10 years.
Mm. Okay, imagine someone's listening to this and they haven't got a clue what we're talking about, but they like the idea of putting money away for their child or their grandchild and let roll over, say, for when they get into high school and they want to pay for private school fees or when they get into university for their HECs.
Okay.
So explain it to us.
Okay, well, we have a product that draws on another life insurance product called a child advancement bond, which have been around decades and decades. And a child advancement bond is simply an insurance bond that is a contract that has built in that it will move from you as owner. So you've got a grandchild, Peter.
Yep.
So young, what's his name?
Sloan Elizabeth
Sloan.
Switzer.
All right, young Sloan.
Yeah.
And you say, look, I've got, I'd like to get this $50,000 to Sloan.
Yeah.
And you could set up an insurance bond, a child advancement bond, and say, I would like this product to be mine, but when Sloan is 22, I would like it to be her insurance bond.
Mm.
And you can designate a purpose.
Right.
So you may say, I'd like to have Sloan have this for a first home deposit or for education or paying off a HEX debt.
Mm.
So, and that's how we're using these modern child advancement bonds.
Yeah.
And when we actually analyse them, very much like a testamentary trust. So effectively, you know, you could say with Sloan, I can put $100,000 for her and your other kids, and you say I would like these to vest as their investments at 22, 18, whatever.
Okay. And if for example, I said, well, look, the kind of money I'd like to give her then is say $50,000.
Yep.
We might have worked out that the fee she needs is $30,000, but we adjust it for inflation, it's $50,000.
Yep.
At this point in time, can you just say, well, to get that kind of money in 20 years' time, you need to deposit this amount in an insurance bond?
Yes, we can.
How reliable is that?
Well, we pass the investment risk back to you, Peter, so there's a menu. So you might say, for Sloan, I'd like this $50,000, but I'm going to put it into a Vanguard Australian Shares Fund because I know that's going to do about 10% after tax, and you can do the math on a 22-year compound.
That was every 7 years.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah, right.
But what we find in not only providing for Sloan, we'll have Gloria who may have six grandkids or eight grandkids. She doesn't really like her own kids that much, so what she does, she uses her will to provide for her own kids.
Skip her kids over and let them roll into the grandchildren.
And then it's a classical sort of case. We'll get eight child builders for Gloria that will vest at, say, age 24, 25, Gloria
can best means that when they can actually access it,
it becomes their investment.
Yeah.
And Gloria can, just like under her will, she could say, this is for the express hope and desire that Sloan will use this to pay off a hex or for a first home. First home's a big problem, and these are very socially desirable.
But can just simply, you don't have to nominate the actual activity.
No, you don't.
That let the amount that these are worth roll over to my grandchild.
Yeah, yeah. So we have a whole menu of life events. Mm. So first home ownership, paying up a wedding, whatever it may be.
Well, you quite surprised me when you mentioned the Vanguard Index Fund or something like that.
Yeah.
So what you're saying is, you can go for a very safe option, which would be built around government bonds.
Term deposits.
Yeah, term deposits.
Yep.
Or you can mix and match.
Absolutely.
50%, say, term deposit, 50% index funds.
Yeah, if Sloan's 50,000, you could say, I'll put 10,000 with Vanguard Index, 10,000 with MLC Balanced, 10,000 into term deposits. There's a whole menu.
And you then would extrapolate what's the likely amount it would be in 10 or 20 years' time.
Peter, we leave it to you, or mainly through financial advisors.
Yeah.
So our menu is 30 options. Mm. They take a sectoral approach. Mm. And, you know, a lot of people just set and forget.
Okay, so basically what you're saying is, and I think a lot of people have question marks around insurance and life insurance.
Yeah.
There are a lot of products out there that meet different kinds of priorities, and people should really make themselves accustomed to those products that are out there.
That's right, yeah. But particularly products that that will have inbuilt estate planning outcomes. So you may well want to have the investment as yours, draw an annuity against it, and the residual amount can automatically go to, say, a charity.
Mm.
So we do a lot of these products where there's a will drawn in respect of the $1 million in the insurance bond, and there's another will that your solicitor draws up.
Yeah.
So.
And I guess a lot of people watching your program would want to know this as well, Ross. Is it upfront what the actual costs are to make this thing happen?
Right. Well, there's no upfront. It's a platform.
But there would, in a sense, there'd be a commission along the way coming out for the advisor.
No.
So there's no money going to the advisor.
We're certainly our business. It's 10 years old. Yeah. We were FOFA before FOFA was invented. Everything's on a agreed fee basis between the client and the financial advisor.
So it's totally upfront.
Totally upfront. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great stuff.
Yeah.
Well, good talking to you. And it's always good to become more mindful of what's going on in the insurance world.
Good luck with Sloan.
Cheers, mate. That's great stuff. That's Ross Higgins from Austoc. Now the Reserve.